Hey guys, I'm John, and welcome to Respect Your Intellect. I'll be answering a few more of your awesome questions today in the second video of the series, so don't forget to hit the like and subscribe buttons, and let's get started! The first question comes from ChrisWit66, who asks, why or how do planets and moons maintain their orbits as opposed to gradually getting closer and closer to the star or planet they're orbiting? Alright, so that's a very good question, but it's one that we have to talk a bit about the initial mechanics of when things are still forming. The first thing to note is that almost everything in the universe is in motion, and when our solar system first formed, it was no exception. One of the main examples that comes to mind when it comes to orbits is Newton's thought experiment of a cannonball. If you imagine that you're sitting at the North Pole and you shoot a cannonball, you have different results depending on the velocity of the cannonball. If the cannonball isn't moving fast enough, the gravitational pull will overpower the orbit and it will eventually fall to the ground. This is a decaying orbit. If the cannonball is moving too fast, it will eventually escape the gravitational pull of the planet and escape into space until it encounters another gravitational body to interact with. This is an open or escape orbit. However, if the cannonball is shot at just the right speed, it will move laterally at the same speed as it falls, so it will never touch the ground and never escape if the forces are balanced. This is a simple orbit, but there are different types of stable orbits. So if we go back to imagining the Sun and planets forming, when the Sun initially gained mass, it's the velocity of the atoms and molecules around it that determines if they're on a decaying, escape, or stable orbit. The slow-traveling ones can only have a stable orbit further out, while faster-traveling ones can only have a stable orbit closer to the Sun. Anything less than stable will gradually fall towards the Sun in a decaying orbit. Anything faster will escape due to an escape orbit. And everything else is stable and already orbiting and maintaining their distance as they go around the Sun. Obviously, this is a gross oversimplification of the whole dance that happens with everything gravitationally affecting each other and gradually changing masses. But what's important to know is that after 4.5 billion years since the formation, the main things that remain are the things that were stable pretty much from the start. Everything else had enough time to either fall into the Sun or a planet, or simply escape, so I hope that answers your question, Chris. The next question comes from Etienne Fortier, who asks, how can we observe the beginning of the universe if we were a product of that ourselves? So in order to properly answer this question, there's a few things we need to go over and take into consideration. The first thing is that we need to establish the distinction between the observable universe, which is what we can see, and the total size of the universe. The total size of the universe is hard to establish since it's outside of what we can see, a bit like the challenges we have about the insides of a black hole. The observable universe is the region of space that we can see because the light will eventually have time to reach us. Anything outside of that bubble is too far away, and the universe's expansion is faster than the speed of light between us and that edge. This means that beyond this edge, even the light traveling directly towards us is still receding away from us faster than it can travel, making it impossible to ever reach us. The observable universe has a radius of about 46 billion light years, for a diameter of about 92 billion light years. This means we can see in all directions around us for 46 billion light years. Since the universe is only 13.8 billion years old, though, we're only able to see the light within that radius at the moment. The rest of the light is still traveling towards us and hasn't had enough time to reach us yet. So as of now, if we look 13.8 billion light years in one direction and then do the same in the opposite direction, we can see objects that are 27.6 billion light years apart. Also, if we left right now and traveled at the speed of light, we could only ever reach a third of the way to the edge of the observable universe. This is because light from the edge already has a 13.8 billion years of head start, and the rest will expand away from us faster than we could reach it if we left today at the speed of light. Now, to answer your question, the furthest light we can see at the moment is the cosmic microwave background radiation, which is from when the universe was 380,000 years old. This serves as a map that we can use to understand how the larger structures of the universe formed, and we can use it to extrapolate data down to the first fractions of a second after the Big Bang. This light is too old to show stars, though, because stars only started forming when the universe was about 200 million years old. With all these new light sources popping up throughout the universe and shooting out light in all directions, it introduced a lot of dots of light that we can focus on, each of which has a different history and distance from us, since we ourselves only formed 4.6 billion years ago. For example, when we look at light about 12.5 billion light years away from when the universe was about 1 billion years old, we see a lot more quasars than we see when we look closer, because they were much more common when the universe was younger. But the light from those quasars isn't light from the very beginning of the universe. It's a completely new source of light that's independent of everything else. So its light is free to travel in all directions, and in our case, we're just standing in the way of that light and can observe it as we intercept it on its straight path away from its source. So even though our history and the history of all other objects in the universe starts at the Big Bang, we don't start emitting light all at the same time. While some stars started showing up when the universe was only 200 million years old, we only showed up when the universe was about 9 billion years old. So the further out we look, the older the light is that we see, but we can't exactly see light from the very beginning of the universe. We're always either looking at individual sources of light that have their own history and distance from us, or we're looking at the afterglow of the Big Bang that permeates the universe. I hope that answers your question, Etienne. Next, we have a question from Lowboy76, who asks if we can really terraform Mars, and he states that it doesn't have a magnetic field. So, as of today, it's true that we don't have the technology to allow the terraforming of Mars. There are people working on this to find solutions to some of the challenges, though. The challenges themselves are significant. Mars only gets about 60% of the light that we get on Earth. It only has about 38% of the Earth's gravity. The atmosphere is toxic. The atmospheric pressure is about 100 times lower than Earth. The lack of a global magnetic field results in harmful ionizing radiation at the surface. The average temperature is minus 63 degrees Celsius compared to 14 degrees Celsius on Earth. Organic molecules are unstable and break down in critical molecules. There's no significant source of liquid water, and there are global dust storms, and the soil is toxic. With all that said, there are some advantages to terraforming Mars if we develop the ability to do it. It's on the outer edge of the habitable zone in our solar system, which would allow for liquid water. There are strong indications that Mars once had an atmosphere as thick as Earth's with liquid water at the surface, so we know it's possible. And the soil contains many of the elements crucial to life, like sulfur, nitrogen, hydrogen, oxygen, and carbon. For terraforming itself, we would need to do three major things: build up the magnetosphere, build up the atmosphere, and raise the temperature. For building the magnetosphere, a concept was proposed to place a magnetic dipole between Mars and the Sun at the L1 orbit. This would protect Mars from the solar winds and avoid stripping its atmosphere, allowing us to build it up. Protecting the Martian atmosphere using a magnetic field is something that could be done with the technology we have today. For building up the atmosphere and raising the temperature, a few concepts have been proposed that include importing ammonia and other hydrocarbons to use as powerful greenhouse gases to trap heat, or using orbital mirrors to direct more sunlight to the surface and heat it directly. Needless to say that this could take at least some decades to find solutions to everything and build the tools we need to accomplish the mission. Not to mention that once the mission starts, it could also potentially take hundreds of years to terraform an entire planet. So for now, it's more reasonable to establish facilities on the surface with the conditions we need to survive. That said, I do see terraforming as something completely solvable in the future, and almost inevitable that we'll eventually get to that point. It would be awesome to colonize the entire solar system and have access to more resources. I hope that answers your question, little boy. For the last question, I'll answer the question that Adventures with Dogs asked that is a bit more on the personal side. He asks when I got interested in astronomy and if I had a substantial outside influence, as well as if I started the channel to address the growing distrust in science that we see recently. So for the first part of the question, I'd have to say that Einstein was probably the most influential figure for me. Every time I learned something about him, I was just wowed by the implications. General relativity, special relativity, and the double slit experiment were the first things I remember really diving into out of pure interest and curiosity. As for astronomy, it's not exactly what interested me the most, because that's more about measuring object positions and characteristics. Instead, for me, it was astrophysics, which seeks to understand astronomy, and cosmology, which is the study of the universe, where just about everything I was learning was giving me the same feeling of awe as with the first three I mentioned. After studying the really large things in the universe, I ended up finding another passion in the extremely small, which introduced me to quantum field theory, with all of the wonders it has to offer in terms of behaviors in the quantum world. The standard model of particle physics also kept my attention for a long time. Later on, I started developing many interests like genomics, medicine, and technological developments. For the last part of your question, I did originally start the channel with the intention of doing 50% straight science and 50% addressing problems with conspiracy theories. After making a good amount of videos on conspiracy theories, though, I lost interest in it. Conspiracy theorists only stay within the same four or five little topics to argue on because they have to keep their view extremely narrow to feel like they have a leg to stand on. So it ends up being the same things repeated over and over again. Science, on the other hand, has an almost infinite amount of wonders to offer, and there's so many achievements lately that we're literally celebrating advancements every month these days. So in short, even though I had the intention of fighting against those movements of willful ignorance, I much prefer spending my time making interesting science videos instead. That's where I'll stop for this video, so if you have any other science questions for me, don't hesitate to ask in the comments. I'll also remind you that my Discord server is also currently open to the public, and this would also be a good place for you guys to come ask your questions. So if you're interested, check the description for the invite link. If you want to follow along or be a participant of this series and get answers to your science questions, make sure to subscribe to the channel and click the bell notification to be notified of all my uploads. You can also check out my website at respectyourintellect.com for all the information on this channel. Until next time, thanks for watching, and remember, respect your intellect.